Welcome to
Hello.
all today's PRL colloquium. Today we have a special lecture, the first Dr. Bibha Chowdhury Memorial Lecture, which is the first lecture of an annual series that we are starting from this year. And this will be delivered by Dr. Archana Sharma from CERN. With this, I now invite our director, Dr. Anil Bharadwaj, for some opening remarks. Over to you, Dr. Bharadwaj.
Thank you, Professor Shubhavati Goswami. Namaskar, Abhinandan, Swagatam. Very good afternoon, good morning, good evening, depending upon which part of the globe you are. Warm greetings from PRL to all the scientific fraternity who has joined us live on WebEx and YouTube. A very hearty welcome to the first Dr. Bibha Chowdhury Memorial Lecture. PRL has instituted the Dr. Bibha Chowdhury Memorial Lecture this year to honor and commemorate the work and life of Dr. Bibha Chowdhury, who spent a majority of her scientific career in PRL starting from the year 1959. Her research work on elementary particle physics and cosmic rays constitutes one of the most pioneering work in Indian science. She formally joined PRL in the year 1966, and she was recruited, or I should say appointed, by none other than Dr. Vikram Sarabhai himself, the founder of PRL and the father of Indian space program. I was going through the personal file of Dr. Bibha Chowdhury and found that she has spent significant amount of her research career in field or outstations, initially in Kodaikanal and later on in polar gold fields. In fact, I could see a letterhead which is addressed as Cosmic Ray Laboratory, Physical Research Laboratory, Bulandshaft, Post Office, Urugaon, Polar Gold Field 2, Mysore State. And she used to write on the letterhead by hand. And I could see many of her handwritten communications between the field station and the PRL campus. And I also see one of her handwritten CV, which probably would be the one which she used to apply to PRL for the position, and which was actually later on typed. So I could see the handwritten version and I could see the typed version. And in one of her handwritten notes, I could see about mentioning of the visit to Aligarh, where she mentions about Professor Y.C. Saxena also, that he is also going to be visiting Aligarh as the PhD student of Dr. Bibha Chowdhury. And we are fortunate that Dr. Y.C. Saxena is here with us and would be giving his reminiscences of his association and his working with Dr. Bibha Chowdhury. Dr. Bibha Chowdhury Memorial Lecture will be an annual event taking place during the month of February and March every year, especially chosen to also celebrate the International Day of Women and Girls in Science, which is on 11th of February, and the International Women's Day, which happens on 8th of March. Keeping the spirit of these 2 days I just mentioned, eminent chosen woman science speaker would be delivering the Dr. Bibha Chowdhury Memorial Lecture every year who work in the field of science, technology, and social science. The first Dr. Vibha Chaudhary Memorial Lecture will be delivered today by an eminent woman scientist and high energy physicist, Dr. Archana Sharma of CERN Laboratory in Geneva, Switzerland. We thank Dr. Sharma for accepting our invitation and agreeing to deliver the lecture today. She would be speaking on unlocking secrets of the universe at CERN. My colleague, Professor Pallam Raju, will formally introduce our speaker. But I was really intrigued by Dr. Sharma's capacity building foundation, which she runs with a name called Life Lab Foundation. And I would really request and urge Dr. Sharma to spend a couple of minutes talking about this foundation, which will be very useful for our listeners and audience. And we all very greatly look forward to the exciting talk by Dr. Sharma. Once again, thanks to everyone joining us live on the occasion of Dr. Vibha Chaudhary Memorial Lecture. Please take good care of yourself, follow COVID protocols, and stay safe. Dhanyavad. Thank you. Thank you very much. You are on mute.
Thank you, Dr. Bharadwaj, for your opening remarks about the Dr. Vibha Chaudhary Memorial Lecture, which PRL is planning to host every year annually. Also, thanks a lot for your sharing interesting information regarding Vibha Chaudhary from PRL records. And at this point, maybe it is pertinent to say a few words about the life and work of Vibha Chaudhary. And so I will share my slides with you to just take you through her journey quickly. One second. Is it visible, my screen?
Yes, we can see it.
Okay, so I will just take you quickly through her journey. And Dr. Vibha Chaudhary was the first woman particle physicist of India. And she studied in Calcutta, did her MSc in 1936 from Rajawajar Science College in Calcutta. And after that, she started working with Professor D.M. Bose in Bose Institute, Calcutta. And they published three papers in Nature on cosmic rays. Professor D.M. Bose was a pioneer in cosmic ray research. And in early 40s, D.M. Bose and Vibha Chaudhary made a path-breaking contribution by identifying cosmic particles having mass close to 200 times the mass of electrons. This was this particle later came to be known as pi mesons. What they did was they exposed photographic emulsion plates at high altitudes in Darjeeling and in Sikkim. However, they could not continue this experiment because they needed much more sensitive emulsion plates, which was not available. But this work formed the basis for more precise determination of the mass of pions by Professor Powell, for which he was awarded the Nobel Prize in 1950. In fact, Professor Powell acknowledged the contribution of Bose and Chaudhary in his work. Vibha Chaudhary went to Manchester in 1945 to do her PhD with Professor P.M.S. Blackett, who was a Nobel Prize winner in 1948. And there she worked on extensive air showers in cosmic rays. And she showed that the density of the penetrating events is proportional to the total particle density of an extensive air shower. This is just in a nutshell. This is a copy of her thesis, and this is a photo of University of Manchester. She came back to India in 1949 and joined TIFR in 1949. And she was there till 1953, and she was working on large air showers using cloud chamber technique. And in fact, she was the first woman researcher to join TIFR, and Professor Bhabha actually invited her to join TIFR. After that, from 1954 to 1958, she visited Ecole Polytechnique, Paris, and University of Michigan. And then she came back in 1959. She joined PRL as a CSIR SRF. And then in 1961, she was a CSIR pool officer. And she was working in the Kodaikanal Observatory. And she got extensive air showers, and she joined PRL as a fellow in 1966. In PRL, she was involved with the study of high energy muons associated with cosmic ray air showers at the Polar Goldfield experiment. She guided one PhD student and PRL, and we are really very lucky to have Dr. Saxena with us, and we will hear more from him. Dr. Diva Chowdhury planned to do an experiment in Mount Abu on radio frequency emission associated with extensive air showers. But after Professor Sarabhai passed away, this did not materialize. She left PRL in 1976 and moved to Calcutta, and was associated with Shah Institute of Nuclear Physics, VECC, and also Indian Association for Cultivation of Science. She published her last paper in 1990. So this is from the CV which Dr. Bharadwaj mentioned, which was typed later. You can see her signature here. This is 62. This is Bibha Chowdhury. I didn't put the handwritten CV because it, you know, the clarity was not so good. But you can see here, this is also little faint, but you can see here 1, 2, 3, 4 Nature papers. And this is her resume in 1962. And however, you know, what is very astonishing is that until recently, many of us have not heard of her. For me, it's very strange because she studied in Calcutta University. She was in Shah Institute, PRL, TIFR, places with which I was associated with in some way or the other. But still, I have not heard of her until recently. A book published in 2018 by science historians Rajinder Singh and Shuprakash Roy, named A Jewel Unearthed, Bibha Chowdhury, brought her work to limelight. Now, the question is that why she was so invisible? Is there an issue of gender involved here? And what in this book they say is that here gender discrimination means that she was not elected as member of any of the three science academies, though her work was of high quality. Chowdhury's name does not figure anywhere in the writing on cosmic particle research done at KGF. An Indian edition of this book is brought out this year by TIFR and TIFR Alumni Association. And you know, this is a picture which I always show. This is a picture in PISA in 1955. And you can see that, you know, you can draw your own conclusions. I don't know whether, you know, if there were, since so few female, what are the kind of atmosphere that she might have faced. But what she said in an interview to Manchester Herald while she was doing PhD is that it is a tragedy that we have so few women physicists today. I can count the women physicists I know in India and England on the fingers of one hand. So she was worried about this, and the question which arises is, has the situation changed? I think we have come a lot way since her time. However, a lot has to be changed also. In 2019, the International Astronomical Union assigned India to name a yellow white dwarf star This was a part of the centenary celebration of IAU, and it was the 100 Name ExoWorld campaign. This star was named Bibha, which in Bengali means a bright beam of light, to honor Indian physicist Dr. Bibha Chowdhury. In fact, this name was suggested by a student from NIT Surat, Aranya Bhattacharya. I think he is in the audience, so I thought I will mention this. So the Dr. Bibha Chowdhury Memorial Lecture is, you know, it's only befitting that PRL starts this to pay our homage to this pioneering scientist. And as our director said, it will celebrate eminent women researchers in the field of science, technology, and social science. And I end with a quote by Tagore, who are you, reader, reading my poems and 100 years hence? So I think Bibha Chowdhury left PRL about a little less than 50 years ago, and it's the right time to start her lecture in her name. And I will just end with a very nice portrait of Dr. Bibha Chowdhury, which came in this Science Illustrated Stories. It was done by Orgo Manna, and you can see how it is illuminating her and her portrait. So with that, I would like to invite Dr. Yogesh Saxena. As we mentioned, her PhD student. Professor Yogesh Saxena is a retired senior professor of Institute for Plasma Research, Gandhinagar. He is one of the founder members of IPR. As a faculty member at Physical Research Laboratory, he was instrumental in starting the experimental plasma physics research at PRL. He did his PhD in cosmic rays under supervision of Dr. Bibha Chowdhury. He is a member, past president, and secretary of Plasma Science Society of India, fellow of Gujarat Science Academy, and past secretary general of Asian Plasma and Fusion Association. Over to you, Dr. Saxena.
Thank you, Professor Goswami, for nice introduction. My share is still off.
I have to stop sharing. Yeah.
Okay, so I will share my screen now, and hopefully I will come to that. Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes, we can. It can be made full screen maybe.
Okay. Yeah, I will make it full size. First of all, I would like to thank Director PRL, Dean PRL, and Professor Goswami for giving me this opportunity to speak on such a occasion, which is starting a series of lectures in memory of Dr. Bibha Chowdhury, who was my guide and mentor. Bibha Chowdhury joined PRL maybe in 1959. I have a number of 58. Maybe I'm wrong. Studies on extensive air shower was Dr. Chowdhury's forte right from the time of her PhD with Professor Blackett. And a new chapter was opened in cosmic research at PRL with installation of extensive air shower experiment at Kodaikanal Observatory of PRL. She spent several years working there. Around 1961, she started planning an investigation of high energy muons of energy greater than 115 GeV associated with the extensive air showers to be carried out at Kodar Gold Fields in collaboration with the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, Bombay, who had a extensive air shower array on the surface. I joined her in 1965 and started working on the preparation of the detector system under her guidance. The basic aim of this experiment was to derive information about characteristics of high energy muons in extensive air showers, their interaction with the rocks and lead, thereby obtain information regarding the nuclear interactions and the composition of the primary cosmic high energy. Here is a small sketch of the experiment which we did at Kolar Gold Field. This experiment was operated between 1965 to 1974. Part of the 65 and 66 were in establishing the laboratory underground. And there's a small sketch of the detector, which consists of a plastic scintillator viewed by two photometric tubes to detect muons reaching that depth in association with the extensive air shower array of TIFR on the surface. And then it had a set of neon rotoscope consisting of neon flash tubes with lead in between and a set of, set of GM counters, which were placed later on to do a local coincidence between the GM counters and plastic detectors. And this detector was placed at a depth of 700 feet underground, enabling filtering out of the particles of energy less than 150 GeV. The choice of the location was dictated mainly by availability of the appropriate space and not by any scientific reason. And the 700 feet made us do experiments at energies above 156 GeV. Interesting results were obtained in this experiment. An experiment was concluded in 1974. And I, of course, got my PhD from this experiment and some of the results from there. I returned to Ahmedabad in around 69 to complete my thesis, which was submitted in 1971, while Dr. Chaudhary continued operating this system with the help of two engineers up to 1974. These are some of the publications which we had from this KGF experiment. And as you can see, most of them are in the Indian journals. And of late, she was always publishing the papers in Indian journals and not going out, though the quality of the paper was unquestionable. Then in the as experiment at Kolar Goldfield Progress, she had a discussion of her plans on experiment to study the radio emission associated with extensive air shower with Professor Sarabhai. This was perhaps triggered by PRL's plan to set up a radio telescope at Mount Abu, which was also under discussion at that time. The plan, however, did not fructify due to the sudden demise of Professor Sarabhai and a subsequent change in the research program of PRL, although the radio telescope did come up at Mount Abu. After completing the analysis of the data which she had collected after I left KGF, she analyzed the data, published the results, and then she retired from PRL in 1976. I will now share some personal reminiscences. Okay. So my first meeting with Dr. Biba Chaudhary was during the coursework, which I was taking as a research scholar at PRL, Ahmedabad in the second half of 1964, early 65. And she gave us a course on the interaction of high energy particles with matter. And this was a very highly impressive series of lectures with full of clarity and lot of explanations. At that time, somehow there was a feeling in the research scholars at PRL that she was a tough person to work with, which turned out to be totally misplaced as discovered during my work with her from 1965 to 1971. When the equipment for Kolar Goldfield got ready, she took it upon herself to go to KGF, arranged for the furnished bungalow, hired from mining authorities, fixed the location of experiment underground in the Bullen shaft before asking me and my colleagues to join there. We shared a bungalow with her, with a third of it occupied by her and remaining by the rest of us. Modest in her approach and in her demand, she did not ask for any special facility from PRL for outstation work at KGF and handled most of the administrative aspects herself. And as Director PRL was mentioned, he has seen handwritten letters from Kolar Goldfield Cosmic Ray Laboratory. That was basically because we didn't have any typist and she had to write everything by hand. Working in mines was a tedious affair, even for non-miners like us who did not dig the gold. She handled that task in a usual calm way. I still have a vivid memory of her in a simple attire, long white coat, a miner's hat, and a long torch in her hand, ready to accompany us to underground laboratory for regular maintenance, checkup, and repairs. Occasional disturbances like fire, gas, flooding, and rock bust, etc., required us to go with mine security personnel with safety gears to switch off and safeguard the equipment. On such occasions, she was not permitted to go, but she would await our return anxiously in the makeshift laboratory on the ground and inquire about our and equipment's welfare. She was an avid reader and had a large collection of books, both scientific and related to literature. I had a good fortune of sharing some of those books with her from her collection. She had an incredibly good understanding of the subject and gave appropriate directions for analyzing and interpretation of the experimental data. In addition to cosmic rays and high energy physics, which she taught me, she also taught me French language to help me with the foreign language examination of Gujarat University, which was an essential part of a PhD curriculum. She was a recognized guide for PhD at Bombay University and had a choice to ask me to register there, which would have required me to seek eligibility to do PhD from Bombay University. She, however, arranged to register me under Professor Vikram Sarabhai, which speaks volumes about her dedication to science without bothering about the credits. She retired in 1976, returned to Calcutta, and a little later started working at IFCS in collaboration with scientists at SINP and Calcutta University. And here is one, the only one picture which I have, which figures her. And this is basically with the old stalwarts of PRL sitting in the front. And at that time, the young faculty of PRL standing behind. And this was perhaps taken at her retirement, though I'm not sure about it. Her last publication, as Professor Goswami mentioned, was in 1990. So she effectively worked for almost a period of more than 55 years, starting from her post-MSc research at Bose Institute and ending with the work at ISCS. My last meeting with Dr. Chaudhary was at her residence at 36 Broad Street, Calcutta, I think in 1978. Why I remember this 36 Broad Street is because when she was on leave, we had to send update to her by post every 5-6 days. And this was the address on which the post was sent. During a symposium at SINP, we took some time off. And myself, Professor P.K. Kao and Professor Abhijit Sen visited her. And she was very happy to see us and welcomed us with her rare smile. She told us about her work at ISCS and asked us how the plasma physics program at PRL was progressing. She also keenly inquired from Professor Kao how was Saxena doing in the new field. A keen sense of satisfaction was visible when Professor Kao informed her of my good progress. So my tribute, I learned a lot from her in my early phase of career, which has served as a building block in my subsequent careers, and I owe her a lot for this. My humble tributes to Vibha Chaudhary, my guide and mentor, a great lady who dedicated her life to the scientific pursuit. Thank you for your attention.
And valuable memory with us. I would now like to request our Dean, Professor Palam Raju, to introduce our today's speaker, Dr. Archana Sharma. Over to you, Professor Raju.
Thank you, Professor Shivaji. It is in fact a great honor for me to introduce the speaker of the first Dr. Vibha Chaudhary Memorial Lecture, who is Dr. Archana Sharma. Dr. Archana Sharma is a principal scientist at the CERN laboratory in Geneva, Switzerland, and has been active in the field since 1989, mainly working on various instrumentation aspects. She is a pioneer in the simulations and experimentation of gaseous detectors in high energy physics for the last three decades. She did her PhD from Delhi University in 1989 in particle physics. Later on, she did a DSc from University of Geneva, 1996. And she has been working at the CERN experiments on R&D and commissioning of large-scale gaseous detectors. She also serves as a senior advisor for relations with international organizations at CERN and focuses on capacity building in India with her LifeLab Foundation. The title of her talk today is Unlocking Secrets of the Universe at CERN. With this brief introduction, I will now invite Dr. Archana Sharma for delivering the first Dr. Vibha Chaudhary Memorial Lecture. Dr. Archana Sharma, please. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Palam Raju. And I am honored by the generous introduction, the kind invitation, the privilege to be giving this lecture is all mine. And I cannot tell you how humbled I am to be chosen to be the first speaker in this series of colloquia that you are going to organize. It is humbling also for the fact that being a woman, I do not wish to go into that direction in my own, let's say, lecture today. But nevertheless, this is a highlight of the theme, and I think that you could not have done better in terms of choosing the theme of women speakers for this series, simply because we do need to encourage the younger generation. And when we see in front of us speakers and work being sort of described, and when I hear about Bibha, you know, literally I was getting goose pimples when I hear that she was already working 700 feet underground in KGF, you know, leading her students, doing things essentially what I think I'm privileged to do today. So this is incredible. And I think that we should bring all this to light and also acknowledge that in her time, I don't think it was very simple to just go in front and stand in front of the men to be showing yourself as a leader. Even daring to lead is already a big thing. So I really am humbled by this opportunity. And I really pay my respects to Dr. Vibha Chaudhary for, first of all, an apology that I did not know so much about her until this was organized, which is also speaking of something that, you know, we do not speak much about our past heroes or women heroes, so to speak. She did publish in Nature. I think we should remember that. And Nature publication today is such a prized accomplishment. And she had three papers in Nature where I have seen that the acknowledgments of her Nobel-winning work were written there by her peers from Manchester, from Blackett, and also from Michigan or Chicago, if I remember. So, in fact, with that, I would like to begin my lecture. It's not really a lecture. It's just a sharing of the excitement of what I do at CERN. And it really touches what Bibha has done, because I am also a nuts and bolts kind of physicist. I do not work too much with equations and theory. So please pardon my lack of depth, so to speak, but I would like to just showcase the work that I am doing at CERN and perhaps connect it with the pioneering work that was done earlier by Bibha Chaudhary. So could I just share my screen? Can you see my screen?
Yes, yes, we can.
Excellent. So yes, the title is quite ambitious, Unlocking Secrets of the Universe. Definitely, we are after many, many secrets of the universe, not only at CERN, but wherever we are in this world of research, scientific research. And the attempt is really to demonstrate how we can do this by means of using and standing on the shoulders of giants like Bibha. So yes, like we heard earlier, it's actually creativity that matters a lot. Imagination matters a lot, as we know from Einstein. And also the novelty that instrumentation brings in the progress of science, particularly in the progress and understanding of the underlying theories in physics and the laws that govern the fundamental building blocks of nature. So definitely technological advances in instrumentation are key, and they are anchors on which the science and the theories move ahead. So what you see here on this slide is a multiplate cloud chamber that is in the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. And thanks to Dr. Nanal, I got this picture from there. And you see perhaps on this on the wall, there is also Jawaharlal Nehru, who was visiting then. And there is a tiny Dr. Bhabha there as well, who have been stalwarts in the field. So it's such a blessing that this is such a connect in terms of instrumentation. And this cloud chamber is one of the cloud chambers that was actually used by Bibha during her work. This is the work she did in Manchester, and you can see that this is a shower in a cloud chamber. And it was also mentioned about her, the name that has been given to the white dwarf, if I remember, or the yellow dwarf, that is Bibha. And it was also proposed by Ananya Bhattacharya, who is also in our audience here. Plus the name proposed by Vidyasagar Daud in Pune, that is for a Sanskrit name for an exoplanet that was actually just the atmosphere which was proposed, that is Santa Masa. So yes, back to curiosity and back to asking questions. Lots of questions we start with when we begin our lives. You know, as kids, we have questions. Where did we come from? What is the universe made of? What happened in the beginning? What is the Big Bang? Where is the universe going? Are there other dimensions? You know, there's a lot of curiosity in us as we go along in our lives, and we continuously ask questions, and we are sort of steered in our life first by parents, then by peers, and then by the work that we do in terms of looking for answers. So in doing that, at CERN, we have found over the many, many years, the progression of the field from the cloud chambers. We have moved to very complex cloud chambers, so to speak. And these are not just one cloud chamber. These are many, many, many detectors that we put together underground to search for secrets of the universe and to search for secrets of some of these questions that we raised earlier. And I will go into a bit of detail on what these pictures and nice color photographs you have seen. So in physics and in particle physics, there are many, many open questions as well, which are being chased actively and have been chased actively over the last decades. One of them is the origin of mass. Another one is the nature of dark matter and dark energy. I think I'm in a company of astronomers and plasma physicists, so I do not need to go into detail on what are these questions, but we all know that we are still hunting for most of the matter and what is it made of, so to speak, which is not visible. So that kind of asymmetry we need to resolve. We need to resolve the asymmetry between matter and antimatter, simply because we are here. So there has to be something that happened at the time of the Big Bang, or a few seconds or minutes after the Big Bang, where matter prevailed and antimatter disappeared somewhere. So is there an antiverse somewhere else? What was this primordial plasma at the time of the Big Bang? We heard about the standard model of particle physics, which is like a periodic table of chemistry. You know, we have just organized all the particles that have been observed into a table, and that forms very nicely three families. And it also tells us that there are four forces and that there are force carriers. But there are still open questions in this standard model. So beyond the standard model, what is there? What are different kinds of other models that have been proposed, like SUSY is a supersymmetric model. There are other open questions on hierarchy, on monopoles, on neutron lifetime, and so on. So these are questions which the younger audience could probably go and look for, let's say first relating to the problem and then looking for solutions. Why? Because there are many, many opportunities that are open in several mega science projects today, not only at CERN, but at FAIR in Germany, in the experiments on astronomy, like the TMT and the SKA and so on. So and India is big partner in many, many mega science projects. So there are so many opportunities for doing astronomy, theory, and experimental particle physics, nuclear physics, or high energy physics as well. Now, to seek these answers, in fact, we at CERN have a large infrastructure, which is a series of accelerators. Each one is feeding the next one, and each one was built over decades, so to speak. So there are, of course, they are being upgraded, they are maintained, and so on. But you have had the possibility of doing your experiments with man-made accelerators. Of course, there are cosmic rays, and I have to admit that I also started my career with cosmic rays, as scanning emulsion plates, which were exposed to 400 GeV protons, and that formed part of my PhD thesis. So we all began with those collisions, and then we graduated into collisions that we can do in our laboratory. And that's what CERN is, and that's where CERN really is, investigates the nature of our universe and the questions that we already posed. So what happens when we look and we find some answers? When we find answers, we are able to impact not only millions, but billions of lives. And today, the big question is, of course, that what is the Large Hadron Collider? You may have heard about it, but we are going to go in a bit of detail. It's being upgraded into a high luminosity Large Hadron Collider, and there is a yet future collider that is coming up, and that is called the Future Circular Collider, and we'll look at that as well. And of course, nobody can do this work by themselves. I am a very tiny, tiny, minuscule cog in this whole world of CERN, where 15,000 people work every single day. And at any given time of day or night or weekend, you will find nearly 5,000 people on site because they are working all the time, as you know very well. And scientists are coming here and are also working in their home countries and their home institutions all over the globe. In this particular picture, you see Nobel laureate Sam Ting right in the center when the LHC was actually inaugurated. So we need to push the limits of technology, and we need these particle accelerators to do experiments. Accelerator is just a tool that we have, and with that tool, we produce collisions that will actually let us to measure the properties of matter and try to answer the questions that we posed earlier. So doing this is actually moving a lot of technology forward. The LHC, the Large Hadron Collider, was approved in 1984. At that moment of time, no one knew which kind of magnets will be used, which kind of cables will be used, which kind of cooling will be used. And this was proposed for a 27 kilometer circumference that it will be built. Tunnel was built in the predecessor of the Large Hadron Collider. And in that tunnel, the LHC was built. So the idea is that you work together with industry and you drive the innovation. And that is the sense of a mega science project. You work through decades so that you are able not only to drive the technologies, you are able to make a very big societal impact as well. So this is a message that fundamental research that we all do really pays societal dividends over a very long time. And I can tell you that physics accounts for 17% of the export, so nearly trillions of euros from Europe. In terms of industries and so on. So yes, there is a lot of physics to be done, a lot of science to be taken out, but there is a lot of societal impact as well. So like the Higgs boson, you have heard about, of course, the Large Hadron Collider, we said, the birth of the web, the antimatter, and of course, the high luminosity LHC that's coming up. So I think I have made a case for scientific research that we do at CERN with cutting edge technology The R&D continues all the time, of course, because we need to do the R&D to be able to do the research that we wish to do. And on the left corner, you see the inside of the tunnel where the Large Hadron Collider is housed, the 27 kilometers, and there are 1,800 of these, 1,200, the big magnets are 1,200, and I think around 880 smaller magnets and corrector magnets and so on. On the right-hand side, you see the DREAM, which is a 100-kilometer collider that is coming up for the future, and that's why it's called a future circular collider. And of course, a lot of social impact, a lot of engagement, and a lot of learning and capacity building for the future as well. So yes, I think for the audience here, I do not need to mention about what is the current understanding of the constituents of matter, but just a small revision is here, right here, that inside the atomic nucleus, we have the protons and the neutrons, and these protons and neutrons collectively are the hadrons, which are strongly interacting particles. They are made of quarks, and that is really the matter that builds all of us. You know, me, you, the table, the nature, and everything is made up of these fundamental particles. But how do we know this? We know because we have been smashing things together and we are trying to see what happens. So let's do a quick experiment. And you, the younger audience, is also scientist with me, and we are doing this experiment. You saw that we started with helicopters made out of Lego. And when we collided these helicopters, they broke down. Of course, the energy wasn't enough that we gave these two helicopters, right? So they did not break up into fundamental constituents. So if we go further and we increase the energy, then what happens? Let's check this out. If this stops, then come on. Okay. Yeah, so we increase the energy, and then when the helicopters break down, they break down into individual pieces. So these are the fun experiments, the play experiments that the scientists have been doing from ages, and that's the source from where we get all our data and information, which helps us build the model of the universe. Of course, this collision energy needs to be really high. Only then we will be able to break into the fundamental particles. So do we think that we have gone into the fundamental particles? We are not sure. We will only know when we increase the energy further, and we will be able to see what exactly is inside the fundamental particles as well, because we can continue this game forever for that matter, right? So here we have the known particles, the leptons, the quarks, and leptons is just another name for the electron, muon, and the tau particles, which just increase in their masses. And of course, we have the 6 quarks on this side, also in increasing mass. And the first family here, the electron neutrino, the up and down quarks, they together make up all the ordinary matter that we are made of. And these particles, the remainder of the particles, are found in cosmic rays. And those are the cosmic rays that have been studied also by Bibha. And also, of course, she has been looking at the resonances. And of course, the pioneering work that she did also led to a lot of follow-up work. Again, let us not forget that there are the force carriers as well. And these force carriers are, first of all, there are 4 forces. All of us know about them: the gravity, electromagnetic force, the strong force, and the weak force. So all these forces are carried by bosons. And these bosons are the photon, the Z boson, the W boson, and the gluons. And how is mass given to these particles? Why are these masses different? This is another question. We have no idea, really, or some idea, so to speak. And that is explained by the Higgs boson. There is this Higgs mechanism, which says that there is a field all around us, and depending on the interaction with this field of that particle, of the particular particle, the mass is given depending on the amount of interaction of this particle with the Higgs field. So all that is a bit complex, I agree, but we can make a very elegant, simple equation, and that can be found on a cup or a t-shirt as well. So we are able to explain the standard model of particle physics with one Lagrangian, and that is written on this cup here. So now we are going back to our game and we increase the energy really high. And instead of particles, we got something else. And what is this something else? Do we believe? What do we see here? We see some dinosaurs coming out of these. Now, these dinosaurs, do we believe that they were dinosaurs? We do believe because we have seen fossils. In the same way, we believe that there must be other particles that we have in the standard model, and we can create more particles that existed at the time of the Big Bang. So it's very unique, so to speak, that in our accelerators, we create particles, we create resonances that were present at the time of the Big Bang, and then they disappeared, just like the dinosaurs. And isn't it ironic that we are here on the foothills of the Jura Mountains, and this is a Jurassic Park, so to speak, so we get to play every single day. And when we do this experiment further, it is a bit crazy, but we are able to create the expected particles from our theories, the hypothetical particles, the unsuspected particles, and of course, the particles that are extinct as well. So very recently, you may have heard in the news that CERN creates a new particle, CERN found a pentaquark, CERN found a tetraquark, and so on. So this is, I mean, every day is a fantastic, let's say, excitement when we get to hear these kind of informations. And of course, we also create the Higgs boson, which is just, of course, which is expected. And this is why the Large Hadron Collider was built. Now, again, a single person is unable to do this. It's very, very important to collaborate. And therefore, we need to have a different set of competencies of people who are able to then help us to come together and then build this kind of an experiment where we will be able to do a multi-billion dollar experiment to give us the physics that we are looking for. Of course, it should be very, very strongly motivated, and that's where our collaboration comes in play. So we have the accelerators. So accelerator physicists who build these powerful machines that accelerate the particles to very, very high energies and bring them into collisions. So the accelerator we have here, it operates at minus 271 degrees, which is just 2 degrees above absolute zero. It's incredible to have 54 kilometers, 27 kilometers of one beam and 27 kilometers of the second beam to be operational in such conditions. Of course, the detectors then, just like the cloud chamber that Viba had was working with, we have to build detectors that can then detect collisions. You know, in the beams, there are protons that are circulating, and then we make them collide. And when they collide, there is a debris that's coming out, and that debris needs to be caught in terms of time and space as well. So those are the detectors that take pictures of the collisions. We need a lot of computing and software to collect and to store and to distribute and to analyze all the data that is produced by these detectors. And collaboration, I already mentioned that every work that we do here is a collaborative science on a global scale. And we have thousands of engineers, technicians, support staff, students, PhD students, young interns, including school students who build and help us to operate these complex machines. That's another picture inside the collider. And these are the two beam pipes I was mentioning. One takes the beam, the proton beam in one direction, and the other one in the counterclockwise direction. And then there are special magnets which focus, and then you have the beam in the experiments for the collisions. So this is an aerial view, as you see. Those are the Jura Mountains there. This is the Geneva airstrip. And we are able then to have collisions, and these collisions are made at 4 different points on the ring, on the 27 kilometers ring, 100 meters below the Earth. And here again, when Dr. Saxena was mentioning about the 700 feet below, I quickly converted it into meters, and that is 213 meters. So it was a moment, I must say, to imagine that Dr. Chaudhary, Biba Chaudhary, was actually working 200 meters underground in India at that moment of time in the 50s and 60s, where today we are, we have this tunnel, of course, a marvel of engineering as well. And we are working underground 100 meters. Here you can see another picture. That's how it is. And these are the four experiments. We have a beautiful Lake Geneva in the center. And of course, we are crossing two countries every time the beams are crossing the border, so to speak. Of course, it's a very big engineering challenge, not only the accelerator, but also the experiments themselves. So imagine a very huge 50 meter long and 20 meter wide in diameter onion, cylindrical onion. And if you slice it, each of these cells or each of these layers represent a different detector, simply because the particles that will be coming out from the collisions will be very different from each other, and the behaviors will be different as well. And we need to catch, in terms of energy, in terms of space, in terms of resolution, in terms of time, where these particles went. So it's just like taking pictures with a mobile camera, but with each of these cells in your experiment, taking data and matching it with the collision point and sending off the full trajectory of the particle for the offline data analysis as well. So that's just a picture. And, we have up to now 59, and I think now the number is 60, new hadrons that have been discovered at the LHC. So these are some of the pictures of the events, which I also flashed earlier in the four experiments, in the different experiments. And as you can see, that just like Biba was looking at the cloud chamber pictures of the cosmic rays, here you see the pictures of the collisions in our detectors, and each cell is coming from a separate technology, so to speak, yet everything is related to each other and then pointing to the collision, matching the energies that is given to us by the accelerator, so that we can reconstruct, and then we are able to figure out what is the physics, what are the signals that we get. And of course, the main focus was to look for the Higgs. So these are two big experiments, multi-purpose experiments. One was called the ATLAS experiment. It is called the ATLAS experiment. And CMS is my experiment where I work. That's a compact muon solenoid experiment. So whatever you see in red here is iron. So it's a very, very heavy detector, 14,500 tons. And this detector has a very strong and very sharp and a very refined muon detection system. And the muon detectors are gaseous detectors, and that's a lot of my work involves on those detectors. And I really feel very related to see the work that was done by Biba Chaudhary also on gaseous detectors, the multiplate chambers and the cloud chamber as well. So, this is an evolution standing on the shoulders of giants. And I think that all women physicists and scientists can relate to how her trajectory has been. So coming to the engineering challenge, as you see, these are very, very large detectors with very, very complicated algorithms on how these every little cable has to go from place A to place B, and all the routing has to be known, etc., etc. I will not go into the detail, but you can imagine the mechanical engineering challenge, the electronic engineering challenge, the electrical engineering challenge, the grounding challenge, etc., etc. So it is a great engineering challenge and a fantastic one too. Imagine lowering a piece of this detector because it was built on the surface and the cavern was still being dug. So when you have to lower the detector, which is a 2000 ton object, which kind of cranes can you use? So that in itself is a challenge. And one of the Swiss companies made a custom made a crane across the building to actually lower this detector. So these are moments where you see how people come together and how the whole collaboration has to work in tandem so that you can match every micron to the centimeters, to the inches, and to the software versions and so on. So it's a very, very big challenge, but it is a demonstration also of the power of collaboration. So talking of challenges, let's look at the data. I mean, we were thinking that, you know, when we started, each event is about 200 gigabytes. And then as we move on, we are now collecting more than 75 petabytes per year. And now, looking to the future, we absolutely need to prepare for exabytes. These numbers are mind-boggling, and we need to be very, let's say, focused and also pragmatic and far-sighted so that we do not succumb to obsolescence. We do not want that our detector stops working after 20 years or 10 years. I remember that the designing was done in the 90s. The building and construction was done in the early 2000s, up to 2005, 6, all the detectors were built and installed, and then they started taking data in 2010. So imagine that 10, 15 years was the building, but electronics obsolescence can happen every, you know, 10 years. New technologies come in for electronics, for software, for all these new, let's say, technologies that we need to meet. Now, coming to the algorithms and the intelligence that is needed to hunt the Higgs is also a very big challenge. And here, first of all, we need a huge amount of data simply because the Higgs itself was very, very rare. That we have the chances to figure to fish one Higgs in 10 to the 11. So it was incredible, and we actually found it. So this is a collision where the Higgs goes into four muons. And of course, it is in my favorite detector, that is the CMS detector. And you can see the four muons very nicely reconstructed in the detector. And of course, CMS is not the only detector, the only experiment. There is also the ATLAS experiment. And both experiments found the Higgs in the summer of 2012. So as you can see, these blips that are looking here as very small and tiny little blips, they were cause of excitement and, you know, exhilaration, so to speak, over 2 years to ensure that what we are speaking is the right thing. The discovery is real. That also needs to be 100% confirmed. And then on July 4th of 2012, there was the official announcement. There was an official seminar. And believe me, I got up at 5 o'clock to go and attend the seminar, but I didn't find a place because there were people camping outside the conference room already at CERN. And there was a conference going on in Australia. This was a large particle physics conference. And this was an announcement made at CERN to the conference in Australia. And of course, this was great. The Higgs particle search was super. It is, of course, it was a eureka moment for all the particle physicists. And see here, even the cartoonist, I was looking for a woman here, and somebody, one of you may help me to find a woman in the cartoon. Yes, so coming to the Nobel Prize that was given in the following year, in October 2013, the Nobel Prize was given to Englert and to Peter Higgs, who had actually made this big theoretical contribution to the mechanism how mass is given to particles. And then this boson is actually called the Higgs boson. And let me also highlight again that we are not alone. There is a big community in India in various institutions which is participating in the CMS experiment as well. And fortunately, you see many, many women here in front who are leading in a lot of analysis. They are participating in many, many, let's say, different aspects of this experiment. Some of them actually at the experiment, some back home. So this is a big, big contribution that was done also from India. And not only in India, but abroad, all over the world, these girls are working at CERN not only on the CMS experiment, but in the Atlas experiment, in the accelerator, in the IT department, and so on. So we have people who are a large number of women who are contributing to the work that is going on in particle physics. And of course, I do not claim that these are all of them. I mean, I just picked a few that I could find easily. And yes, big science brings a lot of Nobel Prizes. There are many Nobel Prizes at CERN. Six of them are highlighted on our web pages. And there are people who are collaborating with CERN and also who have won Nobel Prizes. So it's of course a marker, but it's not the only thing that we should look at. What we should look at is the model on how science has been successful at CERN. And it has actually come from the ground up, because in 1954, when scientists were leaving Europe to go to the United States after the Second World War, they, 12 countries came together and they signed the convention to make a laboratory like CERN. And today it has, you know, it has been building on its success. And today there are 23 member states and large number of non-member states. India is an associate member as well, along with other associate members. So yes, I have been here through a lot of time, so to speak. By now I can say that, because I came here in 1987 during my PhD. And I have now established a lot of, let's say, networks. I have been working on the floor in the laboratory, inside the cavern, pulling pipes, you know, for 5 years. That was my work, and so on. So it's a good, let's say, anchor and a leverage point, which can then help me to bring whatever little I have learned to my country and to the people with whom I have, let's say, some influence, like with the students in India, or with teachers in India. And this is why I set up my Life Lab Foundation, because what I learned, if I had learned 10 years ago or 20 years ago, you know, I could have accelerated in my career as well. So this is the reason why I set up the foundation. And here you see some pictures which are related to some of the activities. I do not want to go in detail there at the moment. So yes, new projects are on the horizon at CERN. And as I mentioned to you, that this is going to be a 100 kilometer circumference for the future circular collider. And it is a lot of opportunity. Coming to applications now, www, as I mentioned in my abstract, of course, this is a young Tim Berners-Lee who made a website at CERN. And I remember being at CERN in 1989 when this was there. And it was a curiosity, you know, what is this? What can we do with this? You know, that was a kind of sentiment, so to speak. And even his boss had told him, vague but exciting. And today, you know, trillions of dollars are, moving around because of the www. And also, if you look at other applications, you know, for bioengineering, for genome experiment as well, for the genome project, for education itself, you know, how to use all the mathematical equations that we have into a very visual explanations for the teachers, for weather forecasting, for disaster management, we can save a lot of human lives and also a lot of money, courtesy the kind of computing tools that we have, the World Wide Web and the grid computing as well, where India, of course, is in the forefront, so to speak. An application of the accelerators themselves is a therapy for cancer. And this is a novel treatment that was really, let's say, in the background going on at CERN in terms of R&D. And it has been translated into industry. And hadron therapy is now, there are 4 centers, I think, in Europe. It's standard practice. So I, again, not able to go into detail, but you can imagine that if you go for a normal radiation therapy at the hospital, the X-rays will damage all the healthy tissues around the tumor. But if you go for targeted radiation with ions or with protons, you are able to deposit energy only at the tumor by tuning the accelerator parameters, so to speak. So this is an interesting area of study. you saw the detectors, how they are looking for the Higgs boson, or they're looking for discovery physics, they're looking for, you know, extra dimension and so on. But they can also be used to image the body just like X-rays. But what is the advantage? You will be able to give very low dose as compared to what you are getting when you go for an X-ray. So these are sensors that have been developed at CERN and in particle physics in general. And there are, of course, you know, it's a big subject in itself, and there's a lot of opportunities here for people who want to be entrepreneurs and who want to convert these technologies into an industrial application. Similarly for computation as well, of course, there is this grid computing for medical data management, for health data, for you know, the meteorological data and so on. Yes, so just to say that more than half of the accelerators of the world are being used for medicine, and hadron therapy is a growing method of treating tumors. You heard about PET, you heard about antimatter that was produced at CERN some years ago, and now we are also transporting it from one place to the other. So who knows? For the moment, it's one of the most expensive material on the planet, but that's how it begins. And soon we might be looking at new treatments and new methodologies with the antimatter particles. Here are some beautiful pictures taken with detectors that were made for particle physics. And this is the first color X-ray that was done in the University of Canterbury, which is a part of CMS as well. And this, imagine the delight of a doctor when he will be able to see things through the body in this manner, in a color contrast way, to do treatments for various kinds. So this has been a revolution. And also it has been one of the highest visited web pages of CERN. Yeah, so I have given you a huge amount of information, and of course it can be very confusing. I remember that when I did my nuclear physics at Banaras Hindu University, everyone used to joke, you know, that nuclear is unclear, which is quite true, because, you know, you end up being very disoriented. So I just wanted to mention that, you know, despite the journey, which is long and tedious, you know, even there are times when you have no idea of what is coming in the future. Somehow or the other, there is a role of mentors. And that also for women is very important, particularly because they do not want to come out. They are not comfortable. They are not able to even stand up in front for a photograph. I can tell you, they are not able to ask a question. They are not able to speak up in a meeting. They are always doubting on themselves. So this acknowledgement and empowerment is very important. And I think that I was very fortunate to have had excellent mentors and teachers in my life. And that really changed my trajectory. I was at CERN, and I got many colleagues who sort of encouraged me to do whatever I would like to do. And in the end of the day, I managed to lead a quite big project. I would not say very big, but quite a big project, which is more than $12 million. And also, you know, inventing technologies, having patents, building a collaboration across 16 countries. I could not have imagined that I can do it, first of all. And that kind of a confidence building mechanism really needs to be there from the very beginning. Those are some of my collaborators. This is in the year, I think, 2005, probably. We had built 500 detectors, resistive plate chambers for CMS together. And fortunately, we had a lot of Indian participation as well. So, I mean, all my network was, you know, charged, and we came together. And I'm so grateful that it was actually possible. But when that technology was at the edge, the RPCs that I mentioned to you earlier, I dreamt of using a new technology that was already, I mean, I had been working on that R&D in the 90s. So I thought, why not we bring that new technology into CMS as well? So I started dreaming of that, and I can tell you it was not an easy path, but, you know, I dared, and I wrote it down, and it was finally approved in 2015. And, you know, in 2019, despite, 2019, the pandemic didn't really start, it came last year. But in 2019, we installed, in one part of CMS, we installed this new detector. And it was in, nearly impossible to believe that it will be possible. But in 2020, we also installed the second part of the detector. And you can see the work that's going on here. And that's really the contribution that came very nicely. And now we have this first new detector of the phase two. Phase two is just a term that has been described for new detectors in Atlas and CMS. And the detector that I described to you, the GEM detector, has been the first phase two detector that has been installed in any experiment at CERN. So you see here now, I'm very proud to show you the muons, the cosmic muons that have been seen now through this new detector. Of course, not by alone, by myself. It is the full team that is working day and night over there. So yes, it's a moment to stop and ask ourselves a question. Am I curious enough? If I can do particle physics, you know, we can do anything, because this skill set that you get, and that's why I was so impressed by reading about Bibha, that she was, you know, putting on her hard hat and going down, and she's doing all this work, which in principle, if I take my mother, because she must be older than my mother, of course, but still imagine that even my mother would not have the guts, so to speak, to go and do that kind of work. So I am all inspired by her, and also in some sense in awe that if she can do it, you know, women today have really the duty to actually take this forward. So particle physics, without going into too much of detail, is that it's a journey. You start with a creative period. You think about your project, what you would like to do. And then you just go for it. You start doing the developments, whether it's on the detector side or whether it's on the software side, you continue to go until you actually inject yourself and engage with the experiment. Sometimes the results are not coming, you know. It takes a long time to get some good results out. But then the skills that you learn are really unique. 70% of our PhD students go to industry. Of that, 67% go to the banking and the finance industry. And I don't think I have to explain any more on all these other fields that you see over here that are really sort of overarching experience that comes from a particle physicist career can be injected in any field that you wish to pursue later on. So yes, in India, I think that there is huge amount of work in terms of that's already going on, so to speak, because there is so much of infrastructure development, engineering development, and opportunities that are coming up for our younger people. And I am also involved in mentoring students, so to speak. I have had, I think if I'm not exaggerating, more than 600 students have actually come to CERN for internship with me. And in India, I have interacted with over 30,000 students in India. And there are various competitions, and I try to help as much as I can. Again, I'm not alone. I have a lot of colleagues and peers and friends, because everyone wants to give back to society what we get. So it's just a matter of organizing what we can do and what could be done. Not only what we can do, but what is actually possible. So just making the anchor and then leveraging the anchor from technology into our country or into the younger generation. Because our country is full of young people, and that's what we need to take forward, I think. So yes, I think there is a lot of opportunity for upskilling for our younger people, aligned with national priorities, of course. There are so many international projects, not only CERN, but mega science projects, as have been mentioned. We need to look at the sustainable development goals that have been laid out to us by the United Nations. And this already provides a roadmap for us so that, you know, what is it that touches me? Is it number three, that is good health, or gender equality, or education, or all of them? So there are so many opportunities that we may want to pick them up. So yes, for the Life Lab Foundation, there is a lot of programs that are going on in terms of inspiring scientists for tomorrow. We have a teachers program as well, and I invite you to do a little Google and you will be able to go there. And here is just a small tribute to the work that is going done in our country, in the scientific arena, in many, many different areas. In fact, you see, this is a small offering in terms of a book, which is called Nobel Dreams of India, that I have written particularly for women scientists. And I hope that you will find the time to actually read it, go through it, share it. It's supposed to be free. Sometimes I see that somebody adds their 49 rupees. So I keep negotiating with the publisher. But it is very important that we spread the message and we spread the possibilities that are actually there in our mega science projects, not only at CERN, but everywhere else as well. So thank you very much for your attention. And once again, I dedicate this talk to Dr. Biba Chaudhary, who has really been an inspiration, and it has been a big learning in all this time to prepare this talk. And I think that this is an amazing opportunity for me and also for my colleagues. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Archana Sharma, for this amazingly exciting, insightful, and informative talk, which you put it so lucidly. It's so complex a topic, so involved with several people, and a highly interdisciplinary work. And it's really amazing that you put it up in a nutshell, in a, you know, in a short time. And also the fascinating work you're doing through this Life Lab. That last slide was very inspiring. It's really wonderful that you're doing what you're doing. And I should say that Dr. Biba Chaudhary had been an experimental physicist. And we have, it's really befitting that you, as another, you know, experimental particle physicist, give the first lecture in this series. And we are really, excited to have you here in this particular talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for the opportunity. Thank you.
I'm sure there'll be just a couple of announcements for our audience. So people who are joining us through YouTube can write in their question, which will be asked here on your behalf. And people who are joining us in this WebEx mode, probably you can yourself ask this question live. Probably for that, you have to go to this, emotion, the reactions, and then you can raise your hand so that speaker microphone will be on. So that's a couple of instructions or guidance. It's not open for questions.
Okay, I see a question from Dr. Namit Mahajan. Namit, would you like to unmute yourself and ask the question? Namit?
I could unmute. Hello, Archana ji. Yeah. Thanks for a very nice talk. Actually, I had two questions. I was typing and it went very fast. So let me ask the general question first. So I read somewhere that during the pandemic year, you have been mentoring or guiding, you guided more than 100 students, if I'm correct, right? Or maybe more. So my question was that we also have been trying to do this. When it comes to theory, it seems somewhat easier, though still difficult. But when it comes to detectors and instruments, how are you able to achieve the best outcome that is possible? Because you're not only talking about simulations, you're actually trying to mentor or guide students with actual instruments. So your sort of remarks or something from which we can also learn.
Thank you, Namitji. I think this is an important question, and it is a very big challenge, as you know. And certainly, I am not successful, first of all, I have to tell you. But I think that our young generation is very happy to meet to talk, to get in a zone where they feel free to even share their ideas. And I try to give them the problem, you know. So, for example, I said that, you know, on cosmic rays, there are detectors that are available freely, on, you know, and you have to go learn about it and tell me from where you can get a completely ready-made kit for looking at cosmic rays. So for a kid who is in first year or in school, for them, this is amazing. And there are things like the cosmic pie you may have heard, and the cosmic watch you may have heard as well. You know, these things, they cost peanuts, and you can actually get them and get the kids going and let their imagination go on how they can convert these little opportunities of interaction into bigger projects for themselves. That is really, I think I'm only giving them the nudge. They are doing the work.
Okay. So my second question was somewhat on technical. What are your thoughts on near future feasibility of a muon collider?
As far as I know, that there are groups at CERN that are looking at the feasibility of muon colliders. Yes, it's going to be very, very difficult. As you know, that there is the FCC-EE, you know, the...
Yeah.
That is already, let's say, quite advanced, and it has been, it has also the, I think there is a sister project in that is the circular electron positron collider in China as well. Mm-hmm. And for the muon, you know, the lifetime becomes an issue, and also being 200 times heavier than the electron, the muon emits 2 billion times than the synchrotron radiation. So we have to understand how to accelerate the muon beams efficiently and bring them repeatedly into collisions. So I'm really not an expert, but again, you know, if technologies can be mastered, then this is definitely a very exciting possibility. I would encourage you to look at, there is a CERN website, I know, of a muon collider, and there is a group that is dedicatedly looking at this. So I encourage you to get in touch with them.
Okay, thanks a lot.
So there is a question from Ketan Patel. Ketan, which is, can you tell us more about the GEM detector? What does it offer for run 3 data, which could have been missed in the first? Okay, so the GEM detector itself, let me just tell you the technical advantage of using a GEM detector as compared to the previous generation of detectors that are already sitting there in CMS. So in CMS, you have seen that it is like an onion, big onion. In the center, there is a collision point, and then you have technologies, different technologies, covering 4π around the collision point. There is a muon system with 3 different technologies already there. There are cathode strip chambers, there are resistive plate chambers, and there are drift tubes already operational, doing very well and a very good job. Now, in the very forward region, the radiation is very high. So the rate capability and the longevity of these detectors is to question. Therefore, the GEM detector, which is a planar detector, it is based on a foil of Kapton, which is copper clad on both sides and is perforated by millions of holes, which are 50 microns in diameter and 140 micron in pitch. So you have millions of these holes, and if you apply a small voltage across this foil, you are creating an electric field which is very high in the hole, and that acts as a multiplier. So gas electron multiplier. So with a very little voltage, you are able to multiply. If you compare it with a resistive plate chamber, you need a kilovolt, or not a kilovolt, sorry, 10 kilovolts to get a similar signal from a resistive plate chamber, where you can get with a few hundred volts in a GEM, right? So you are already separating the effects of very high radiation and longevity, which means rate capability and aging, in a GEM detector and an RPC and wire chambers, so to speak. So bringing GEM detectors, you are raising the possibility of catching muons that you were missing earlier. And if I remember well, because now, you know, the work has been overtaken by my students and I'm getting more and more behind in many things. but there is a 35% more chance of catching a Higgs boson in this zone where we have implemented the GEM detector. Similarly, we may find discovery physics. So there are different fractions that have been calculated, and we have demonstrated that we definitely bring an added advantage to CMS. Okay, so there is a question from Bijay Kumar Sahu. Bijay, are you online? Okay, then I will read the question, which is, what is the new particle that CERN is aiming to detect next? Well, we have these multi-purpose detectors. So we are tightening our traps, so to speak, and we will be looking at new physics. We will be looking at dark energy candidates. We will be looking at supersymmetry candidates. And, you know, again, I have to say I'm not the expert. You know, I'm building the tools, and we have to look at the physicists, and they will tell us exactly what is beyond the standard model that we want to fish out. And I think that there are some signs and signals and, let's say, hints in LHCb. You may have heard of some new physics possibilities. I mean, again, the confidence level is only 3.1. So we have to wait for more data, and only then we can say something. So, yes, there are very exciting times coming up. So he had another question in YouTube, which is, do you see any signatures of a new bosonic particle that is also responsible for parity violation?
So again, I will refer to the experts for this kind of question, because I mean, we have created the possibilities of measurements, increased the, let's say, our volume of response, the sensitive areas, and also the phase space where we can not miss any new signal. So if there is going to be a new Higgs and let's say Higgs decays, which have actually been seen before, I think, as far as I remember, it will be definitely, let's say we will not miss it if we see it.
So there is another question from Bhaskar Mukherjee. Do you see any signature of a What about the radiation-induced damage in microelectronics interface to GEM detectors?
Yes, this is one of the conditions when your proposal is approved. You have to be able to go through many, many reviews. And these reviews are dedicated to not only the technology, First of all, the motivation. You know, you need a physics motivation for the whole upgrade, whatever you're proposing. You need to demonstrate that your detector is going to operate in a stable manner, in the most efficient manner, for 20 years. And that means not only the foils, not only the on-detector electronics, off-detector electronics, all the everything, even including a single glue that you put in the detector, and which is one of the advantages of the GEM detector, that there is no glue in the detector. In fact, that was one of the reasons why we made the new technologies on how we will assemble the detectors, and also on the fact that we use argon CO2, which means no flammable gas and no toxic gas like freon or isobutane. Because of all the new, let's say, rules that are coming in of the environment and so on.
Okay, so there is a question again in YouTube from Dr. Surendra Singh. Some scientists are talking about subquarks. Any plan to detect them in future accelerators?
Well, surprises are very regular at CERN, and if there is any surprise, first we will try to catch it at HLLHC, if it is possible, and if not, then the Future Circular Collider is being readied for any kind of surprises. There are also other stops in between, like the ILC and the Chinese collider as well. So, yeah, we have to wait and see. I think for surprises, we cannot say much more at the moment.
So there is another question from P. Singh. What is the timeline for FCC? Has the work on this project started?
Yes, indeed. There has been very active discussion of the strategy of particle physics, the European strategy of particle physics at CERN, because CERN is leading that strategy. And the FCC is on track, so to speak, to implement the strategy. So work has started, groups have formed, and they are there with proposals that we had, for example, for CMS 3 decades ago. So work is ongoing, and you can imagine that if there are ideas coming on the table now, then by 2050, 2045, we should have at least big parts of the FCC already operational or in place, you know.
So there is a last question from Kritika Zamre. Is there guidance for Indian students to apply to CERN internships as bachelor students?
Okay, bachelor students are very welcome, and even there are semester exchange programs, there are junior fellowship programs, there are summer student programs, there are internships. I encourage you to look on the website, because all information is given on the website. You know, you go to careers.cern and you'll find everything over there.
So, okay, I think with that, we come to the end of the question answer session. And now it's a pleasant job to read out a vote of thanks. And so I will first start by thanking today's speaker, Dr. Archana Sharma, for agreeing to deliver this lecture at a very short notice, and for her scintillating talk, especially connecting to the work of Dr. Vibha Chowdhury, and also discussing a lot of social impacts of the work that is done to primarily to explore particle physics, and from there, what is that the social impact of the work that is done in CERN. Thank you, Dr. Sharma. Thanks a lot. I would also like to thank Dr. Saxena for sharing his valuable memories and for enlightening us about the work of Vibha Chowdhury, which she did at PRL. I would like to thank our director, Dr. Anil Bharadwaj, for his encouragement, active involvement, and guidance at every stage of this, of planning this annual lecture series. I thank our dean, Dr. Palam Raju, for being always available for discussion and his advice. I would like to thank my colleague, Dr. Vijaya Sahu, for his useful suggestions. I thank Dr. Bhushit Vaishnav for taking care of all the arrangements related to the poster preparation, announcement, handling the online platform. I would also like to thank our staff, Mr. Senthil Babu, Dr. Pragya Pandey, and also Dr. Vaishnav for their help in finding information regarding Dr. Chowdhury from PRL records. And last but not the least, I would like to thank the audience, without whom no event can be successful. So with this, thanks a lot. In the YouTube, there are many comments that, you know, you can see that the talk was very useful, informative. And thanks a lot, Dr. Sharma, for joining us. And on behalf of PRL, I would like to thank you again, and to Dr. Saxena. And with this, close the event.
On my behalf and on behalf of PRL, I would like to thank everyone who has joined us live on this program, and of course, for the very exciting and informative talk by Dr. Archana Sharma. And thank you all very much for joining us live, and Saxena ji for giving a very good reminiscences of the work done by Dr. Vibha Chowdhury. Thank you all. Take care of yourself in this pandemic.